Good. Then, hello and welcome to our Global Network Forum, GNF, about industry contribution to a... It was when we started to draft, it was the gateway, the deep space gateway. Then in between it became the lunar orbital platform, and now it is the gateway. So you see there's evolution. The realm seems to be a bit oversized here, so if you don't mind, if you want, please come on, go here more to the first rows. That would make the atmosphere, I think, a bit more better for us and also better for the Q&A later. Yeah, if you want, you have now the opportunity to not to listen and to see a few things about our ideas, but also you have the opportunity to talk directly to an engineer who is involved in the industrial study. Great, thank you, thank you. Yeah, we have heard it through this conference, not only the moon is a topic, but also the gateway is a topic that is going around. We are going to the moon and we are doing this sustainable. This was what the NASA Administrator Bridenstine said, but many others as well. You heard Jan Werner, you maybe also heard Dave Parker from ESA, and they all tell the story. And Orion is a key to build the gateway. The gateway is an international endeavor, many, many partners, industry side and agency side, a real exciting time we are going through at the moment. We are currently preparing also the industrial contribution for that, together with our customers ESA, if I speak here for the European participation, and also industrial partners. We will hear later from that. And you may have read this, but Detlef will tell a bit more about this. We had recently been awarded two studies to work on the lunar platform. Now I say lunar platform, it is the gateway meanwhile, as did others, as Thales, for instance, as well. And I will make it now short and close, and I would like to introduce my colleague, and I ask you for a warm welcome to Detlef Wilde at Airbus, the program manager for the Gateway program. Thank you and enjoy.
Yeah, Ziggy, thank you for the introduction. I think we all have seen here these days that there are a lot of things on display, on Orion, on MPCV, on the Gateway. There's a lot of discussion in the different talks. And so actually, it's not just talk. Siegfried just introduced, here in Bremen and elsewhere in Europe, we have already started to work on the Gateway. This is what may not be known so far. The ESA has asked the European prime companies, and I see Matthias and Xavier also around here from our friends in TAS and OHB. Since 2016, we have supported these activities in different study levels in order to both define, support ESA in the definition of the gateway together with the partners of ESA, which is NASA, America, the Russians, the Japanese and Canadians. So to define that overall technically, but also to find out what could be a suitable contribution which we can take from Europe with the background we have gained in particular in human spaceflight, but also in satellite technology in the last decades. And so that's what I'm going to give you a little overview here in the presentation. So a bit about what the objective of the gateway itself is. How it looks like, what are the scenarios, and what are the potential contributions we may provide from Europe in this international endeavor. Let's see, now that works fine. So imagine we are in 2026, I hope, and this is not the International Space Station, so the experts will anyway see the difference. It's a human outpost, and it's around the moon. You see the Earth a little bit in the back. Famous photo you some remember from Apollo 8 in 1968. So this is a gateway in its phase one configuration, roughly in 2026, orbiting the moon as a gateway as a hub, which shall suit two main purposes. We want to prepare eventually a human missions to Mars, and we cannot go there in one step. We need to prepare that. We have to learn to live, to work, to develop equipments in an orbit which is, simulating the interplanetary flight conditions in a good way, but still being not so far from Earth as when we eventually really go to Mars. The other purpose is, and this is the suitability of that hub, is that it will very well serve the exploration and the sustainable return to the Moon. The orbit, I will show you that a little bit later, is well suited to also reach the Moon, to land on the Moon, come back to the Moon, particularly also to go to regions on the Moon where we have never been, which namely are the polar regions of the Moon, which, for example, during the Apollo missions, for different reasons, have never been visited. Apollo was more in the equatorial regions of the Moon. So this would be a second important utilization, and that's where the name Gateway, of course, well fits in terms of defining the objectives for both of that. The picture you see here is a current configuration of the gateway. We have seen, and my colleagues can confirm, we have seen some evolutions of that over the last almost 3 years. There will be certainly further evolutions throughout my presentation. You will see there's not each picture shows the same one. This is a bit historically, and the further evolution will also be showing some changes in that. But I will show you as good as we know the current configuration. Maybe as an additional information, as we speak, we have for the one element, the international habitat, which we are working particular here at Airbus in Bremen. We have currently a meeting with NASA at the European Space Agency in the Netherlands, where we are discussing the definition. And I know the same is ongoing with NASA and the international partners for the ESPRI module in the other area. So these works are running in the studies. For the experts, we are currently doing the so-called phase AB1 studies with the objective for completing the system requirements review in summer next year. So that's the objective. With the aim, of course, if things work out, that we may get decisions on the program in the ministerial conference coming at the end of 2019 or early 2020. So a little bit on these objectives. I think you may have seen that chart from NASA. So we are operating the International Space Station, as you know very well, very successfully for a long time. So we may say it's 20 years this year with the first launch of the FGB. Columbus is in operation now for 10 years, very successful. And as of today, there's the first German commander on the International Space Station. So fits very well, all of that. So with the objective to further explore the universe, the gateway will be suiting at first to operate in the lunar vicinity. That's what we want to achieve in the 2020 timeframe with the gateway. And with, of course, then the further goal also here to prepare eventually the manned mission to Mars. And there, with the gateway, we will get a lot of experience, both in operationally and in the development of the suitable equipments coming from the International Space Station, which is an important reference in order to do that. However, flying to and around the Moon is not exactly the same as in low Earth orbit. There are some different challenges. Radiation, for example, is a much more severe thing. The good thing is that the lunar environment, for example, is not so much spoiled by debris so far, at least, than the low Earth orbit. So this is maybe on the good side, and of course we want to ensure that this is going on. So there are different technological challenges involved. That's what I want to stress, and this is what we want to achieve also with the gateway. Coming from the know-how, experiences in the operation, we need to further advance that technology and operational experience in order to prepare for those flights. And for this, we will see that later, also a very particular orbit has been selected. So those of you who are familiar with orbital dynamics, you will kind of stretch your heads how that's going to work. So it's quite an interesting thing. I'll have a little bit on more on that later on. Looking a bit on the functions of the gateway, I'm not going into all the details, don't worry. But the main specification points are that it's made for a crew of four. The crew will be always transported by an Orion launch to the gateway to operate the gateway. So in general, the gateway will be supported by Orion launches, but also by commercial launch vehicles transporting logistics and other elements. Missions for the crew will be between 30 to 90 days, depending on the size of the system. Flying to the moon is much more expensive in terms of fuel than going to low Earth orbit. So this is one reason why the size is smaller than the space station. There will be a smaller crew, and also the duration time will be more limited, and there will be, at least for now, there's no permanent manned operation foreseen. Looking on the volume, you see here 125 cubic meters. Maybe that doesn't tell you a lot. If you consider that on the space station, each of the six crew members has roughly 100 cubic meters for each alone. 125 have to be shared by four, so it might get a bit small in there, so I think you need some good friends when you go up. But so that's really a challenge in terms of having a proper design of the system. And if you have seen pictures from the space station, the interior, it's a laboratory growing over time. It has its challenges. So having a kind of sufficiently comfortable living opportunities for a crew, the aspect of interior habitation design, living conditions in such a very small volume is one of the key factors in the design of the system. And there will be different solutions than on the International Space Station that will have to be used to support that. As already mentioned, the orbit we are using, this is an orbit around the moon. I'll show you later on. It takes 6 days to go around the moon in a very high elliptical orbit, as indicated here in the picture. And that has its particular advantages, which I will later on explain to you. So here are the elements where it's made of. So it's a bit more easy to count through. So first element will be the so-called power propulsion element you see on the left with a large solar arrays. So this will be the main energy propulsion element to control, drive the system, providing fuel, driving, controlling the flight. This will be launched in according to the current plans in 2022 by a commercial launch vehicle, and it will then go into the target orbit, and it will basically serve as, if you will, the first seat of the gateway, where then step by step the system will be further built. Second launch would be 1 year later, where the points B and C in this picture, the ESPRI module, coming from Europe as a service system, combined with the American utilization element, will be launched with an Orion. And according to the current roadmap, this will be the third flight of Orion with the third service module. So you've heard here, we are here in Bremen, we are just these weeks in the final integration and testing of the first service module to be delivered to the US soon for the first test flight next year. So the third service module in the production, if you will, small series, of course, compared to cars, will be then used in 2023, according to the current plan, to launch the combined stack of the ESPRI and utilization element modules. Then from the next elements in the row are the two habitation modules according to the current design. So there will be one which is called and which is also planned to be launched as the first one in 2024, the so-called International Habitat under the leadership of ESA, with contributions from other partners like the Japanese. will be launched. So this you will see then the designs you will see a little bit later. And the second habitation module is planned to be an American one, to be provided by an American company, still to be selected as far as we know. And this is also here indicated. Both then will be the combined, let's say, living and working space for the core crew members. So the core of the gateway then will be then completed by a crew airlock. The yellow one on the next to the Orion capsule. This crew airlock will be available for crew excursions outside the gateway, as we also need it for operation of the International Space Station. And another important element, as you see also, there's an external robotic arm, which you can see under F. It's maybe a bit small in the picture. So this is a robotic arm which our Canadian colleagues, like for the space station, intend to provide in order to have the external, let's say, servicing and operation of the system supported. And the whole thing will be operated and serviced with flights of the Orion. And also you see that on the right side, also indicating in pink the service modules. So if you look around the gateway with the Esprit, with the International Habitat, and the service module production elements, there's a very good potential for Europe to take an important role here in the gateway, in order to prepare and support this elements, and then also hopefully with the opportunity that European astronauts can go there. So here's a bit summary of the build-up of the system. This is not, of course, not growing all in one shot. It will go through the 2022-2026 time frame according to the current plan, where it goes stepwise. And you see also the sequencing of commercial and SLS launches. We are somewhat alternating for the different elements, and then also step by step growing the capabilities of the gateway until the completion via the airlock. Which not indicated is here, which we see that Laos again, is then the support by logistic vehicles, but also the serving of the utilization of the system as a gateway where you may be the target for a lunar ascent vehicle, bringing back probes from a lunar sample return mission, and to support this scenario, which at ESA is currently in preparation under the title of Heracles. So, and having done all that after all this build up, we see this complete stack then mounted. Here is also you see that logistic vehicle. Maybe the arm is a bit better visible, and here where the whole system can be seen. In the picture here, you still see that both habitats have a kind of identical design. That's probably in the end not the solution. There could well be the case that one of the two, an American one, might also be an inflatable element. You know, there are developments, there are concepts for inflatable habitats which could be used. So this is one of the options for one of the habitation modules. The European design is as we have it right now, is more based on the heritage we have from Spacelab, Columbus, Nodes, MPLM, more a hard shell module which is a very well proven and reliable design which we work in Europe. So having completed all that, a little story about how do we get there and how do we fly there. So launches will be here, as you can see. This is the SLS, the new Saturn V, with a launch from Kennedy Space Center on top of the rocket. The Habitat or Esprit, they will be so-called co-manifested payloads on an SLS launch. So the SLS with an Orion, they have a, call it, spare capacity of around 10 tons, and that can be used to launch elements to be transported into the target orbit. The approach is those of you who know Apollo is basically similar. You have the capsule with the launch escape system on top of the rocket, and below in the payload, under the payload fairing, you have not attached to the capsule, you have the payload. Could be the habitat, like the lunar module in the Apollo times. Then after launch, after leaving Earth's orbit, the Orion will undock, will turn around, fly back, and they will kind of drag out the co-manifested payload from the upper stage, from the fairing, and then will make its flight to the moon. Flying to the target orbit is a bit different than flying to the moon in Apollo times, or when you want to go in a low lunar equatorial orbit. What we do here, we fly roughly four days, and then we do a propelled gravity assist through either the lunar north or south pole in order to reach the target orbit. It's a bit complex, but it's required in order to reach that particular orbit, the so-called non-rectilinear halo orbit. This is coming a bit later in a more detailed explanation for the flight. Then after about 6 days after launch, we'll be reaching the gateway here for the example of the habitat, but it's the same as for the other modules. The Orion is doing the docking to the existing gateway in order to, let's say, build a stack step by step. If you see that will remember you a bit on a docking of an ATV to the space station or on other elements. Launch of a shuttle with, for example, Columbus was different because then there the Columbus was in the cargo bay and taken out. But this is, I think, a well-expected configuration. So if we look on this orbit, and there's a little animation on how that orbit works, I'll explain that in a little bit more detail now. So the idea is flying around the moon, one would like to have an orbit which pretty well simulates interplanetary flight conditions to the extent possible, of course. If you would be, for example, in a low lunar orbit, you would be having sun shadow eclipse several times a day, like you have it in an Earth orbit for the space station, you have it 16 times a day. So your whole energy system, your whole thermal system is designed for doing that. When you fly interplanetary, you don't have that. You have constant sunlight, which has pros and cons. Communication, when you fly around the Earth or around the Moon, you will not have constant communication links to your Earth ground station, for example. When you fly in an orbit which is, let's say, not obstructed, has not an obstructed view to Earth, you have basically the same radio conditions like flying interplanetary. And this is what this kind of orbit can achieve. Of course, we cannot simulate the flight into the solar system by having a longer distance to the sun, reduced sun illumination, or the radio communication delay to Earth. But this orbit supports that very well. The physical phenomena behind that is the orbit is almost perpendicular to the ecliptic plane. It has an orbit. It has an aposelenium, so the maximum distance from the moon is around 70,000 kilometers, and the closest distance, the pericenter, is around 2,000 kilometers. With this, and highly above the moon, the disturbing torques from moon and Earth combined ensure that this orbit is kind of rotating around the Earth in a bounded rotation, a little bit similar as the moon does it when it rotates around the Earth, and this ensures this very nice, how to say, bounded flight around the Earth, very well simulating these interplanetary flight conditions in a suitable way, while you can reach the orbit from the moon from that orbit very, very easily. So, and this is really supporting the development of the operational and technical heritage for those kind of further missions in a very, very well manner. As said, the Heracles scenario from ESA is meant to use the gateway as a hub for lunar exploration. Here are some first sketches where you can use basically the the availability of the gateway for as a staging point to go down to the moon, to go back to Earth, to bring up samples, to bring the samples back then to Earth in an Orion capsule, so you don't have to build a full lunar polar sample return mission, for example. So all that can be used for, beside the aspect of that the gateway of course shall prepare the further flights for Mars, as it is the main intention for NASA. So here another element where such kind of an element, here a lunar ascent vehicle, is using the docking ports of the gateway to attach to it and to be serviced by it. Could be done by a docking or using the robotic arm in a similar way as on the space station to do a birthing scenario. So as said, in the works we have done with NASA and the other international partners, we've been identifying two elements which could be European contributions out of that, and where we have started in spring with the phase AB1 studies. The one is the International Habitat, the other one the ESPRI module. The International Habitat, we're working here mainly for an Airbus from the Bremen side with a team of European companies. The ESPRI module is worked by our colleagues in France, in Toulouse. This has good reason, because the ESPRI module is more using, let's say, satellite technology know-how in the area, where for the Habitat, our experiences on the Columbus modules play a major role. So here we are really very well complementing and can use, with mutual support, these experiences. Also in these studies, which I think is important, is that we also have the chance here to already start to integrate other companies inside Europe. In the European frame, ESA, it's usual that we have participation from different member states in order to use their experience and their support. And this is what already we can start here in the study. So we have companies from Spain, from Belgium, from Austria, Switzerland. They're already supporting here the activities. So some first views on the two elements we are working on. So this gives you a little sketch. You will see that in the animation later on, a bit more detail. This is the International Habitat. It's pretty much the size of the Columbus. The reason is not that we like that size so much, but with the constraints we have for the 10 tons, as mentioned before, this pretty much turns into that kind of sizing. The diameter of the module, like for the Columbus, to use that parameter again, is 4.5 meters. The length is almost 7 meters, which then gives you around 70 cubic meter of internal volume. We have four docking ports, two on the longitudinal, two on the radial side. What is important is here, for those who know the designs of the space station, we are not going to use the international standard payload racks here. We do not have so much modules to exchange them, and they are pretty heavy and not so flexible as we would need it for the design here. So what we look for in the design, and you have here some first illustrations, we really need to have a more flexible design of the interior of the system in terms of internal architecture, to make efficient use of the scarce source of the volume we have here. To do those work, we also started to introduce new technologies in the design. Model-based system engineering is a key word on that, but also virtual reality. I think you have seen on the Airbus booth this virtual reality simulation or animation. We don't have this one here on display. These are just some screenshots of how that looks like. This does not really give you the 3D impression, obviously, when you see that here on the screen. But particular to evaluate this internal architectures, to play with internal, layout of furniture, if you will, those tools are extremely helpful and can give you a very, very good impression. So you see an example where some crew members are inside the module in an integration hall, so to show that, Second one is also with a little bit in the internal, where you see some first ideas on the internal architecture. Internal robotics will also play a key role that in addition to the external robotics as on ISS has turned into an important requirement in order to operate the system both during the uncrewed phase, which will be the longer part of the year, but also for the crewed phase, to support the crew operation and to have that as efficient as possible. Yeah, last but not least, some sketches of the ESPRI module, as say they currently are. So the ESPRI, as said, it combines important functionalities in terms of the refueling of the power propulsion element to provide the necessary fueling sources. The power propulsion element will be mainly using electric propulsion. So refueling of, for example, xenon is a topic. There's a lunar communication, Earth communication, high data rate communication, an important aspect. There is the aspect of a science airlock, where we can bring in and out scientific equipment, and also the aspect of external payloads indicated here in green, where we can use that element similar to the space station. It's not a Bartolomeo design here, but also to support internal and external, like the habitats utilization of the system. So these are some first ideas and sketches on those concepts and the overall architecture. And before I give a summary, I have a little video, I hope that's going to start, summarizing a bit this scenario. I think we should view that before we can conclude on it and have some questions. In the title, you see that there has been some evolution, as I mentioned already. So the architecture we see here is not the very latest one we have, but as I said, it's anyway an evolution. So we see here the launch phase from an Orion MPCV, then the insertion into the transfer orbit to the moon. So far that's classic. And then, as I've mentioned, we have this propelled flyby on the lunar, in this case, the South Pole, as we have a northbound orbit selected here for the animation. So then, after this gravity assist, roughly a day after it, we are inserted into the non-rectilinear hollow orbit, and then we perform the flight with the docking to the gateway. Here's the example of the habitat. It would be here the second habitat in that configuration. Docking it in. Use here is our new docking systems under development in Europe and in the United States, the so-called IBDM system foreseen. So here again you see the animation of the system, both the flight around the orbit and this bounded rotation of the orbit around the Earth. So like some first animation on the internal layout and the crew, how they would be working in. One function, of course, to control, of course, the robot arm internally out of the habitat. This would be a little example of how to flexibly use the volume to fold the sleeping bags during day in order to have space. And here also you see the utilization as a habitat function with the different elements. For the experts, Matthias Xavier, this is a concept from 2016 still, but we are getting back to it a little bit. So, and also the propulsion. So at that time we didn't have ESPRI, so just to recognize, this was new last year, but now we have again the two habitation modules, which in the meantime disappeared. They are coming back now. So you see this evolution of the architecture. And here the view of the support for the lunar missions, but also with a look to the view to the further destination, in order to prepare for the human exploration endeavor, and with of course the aim to have the human mission to Mars. So yeah, that was a little introduction and overview on where we are with the gateway. I think we all think that this is really an exciting a program. It will really give, yeah, it will give destination to MPCV Orion, and it will be the next step for the human exploration of the solar system, as we believe. And coming back to the motto of the ISC by saying involving everyone, as you have seen with the involvement of all the partners of the International Space Station. And inside Europe, with the involvement of also a quite broad community on the industrial side already, this is really involving maybe not yet everyone, but quite a lot already. And we hope this will be ongoing in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Detlef, for that very interesting insight. We have the opportunity for a few questions, if you want. Is someone here in the audience that would like to question? Just out here.
Thank you for the presentation, really. This is interesting. So I have a question first about these modules that you're developing that are going to be different than the ones that you use on the ISS. Who is developing this? Only one nation or more of them together?
No, as said, it will be a cooperation of different nations. So there is a current, let's say, work share for different modules. Nothing is finally settled because all that has to be decided by the related authorities. In the current configuration, the power propulsion element is United States. The ESPRI is Europe. We have two parallel studies running on that. I think it's not a secret. One is done by Airbus, one is done by TAS, together with OHB, so both companies in Bremen are involved. The utilization element is American companies in the US. They are the so-called next step studies running right now with, I think, six companies who, as far as I know, are working on concepts for these elements. Then with the international habitat would be European in the current workshop, domestic habitat, which also again work current studies on Airbus and TAS side. Then we have the US habitation module would be a US company, the ALOC Russian, and MPCV Orion is American European, if you will. So, but for the gateway elements itself, this is the current work distribution. And nothing of that is, of course, finally decided.
And about the IBDM system that you mentioned for the docking, will also the maybe Dragon and the Starliner be able to dock with this system, or is it only for the Orion?
There is the definition of the what they have commercial logistics is a topic which NASA intends to pursue. We have not seen real concepts who is going to provide that, if there will be evolutions of Dragon or Cygnus on that, but that could be a concept. In any case, there is the commercial logistics is a topic for this gateway under consideration. You have seen that in some of the pictures with these attached modules on the side, typically on a level of a 1 year rate, those kind of logistics flights would be necessary to support the gateway.
Thank you for the interesting lecture. My question is, how will gateway differ from ISS in terms of radiation exposure, and will this be a limiting factor that you mentioned, like we cannot stay for longer duration there? Is that a limiting factor?
This is a key topic which is under investigation. Of course, radiation in around the moon without the protecting Earth's magnetic field is more critical, without doubt. How this is operation, it's not constant, so how this is operationally managed is one of the key considerations we are doing. The limitation in time is not only based on that, but it's also based on the logistic capabilities we have up there. So even without a radiation topic, this would be give limitations. As said, flying to the moon and back, delta V wise, is a different story. And therefore, this permanent crewed situation is much more difficult to achieve. So it's not only linked to radiation, that's clear.
Thank you for the presentation. Can you give us a little insight on the schedule on the program? So when the first module is going to be launched and when it's going to be completed?
So the current roadmap in general is, you know, the MPCV is doing the is planned for having two test flights.
They are not coupled to the current scenario. There were initially some ideas that the PPE may be flying on the second Orion launch. This is by now changed. So these flights are in 2019-20, the first unmanned test flight around the moon, 22, the first manned Orion. To prepare, this is of course our essential prerequisites. The ESPRI launch currently is foreseen in the roadmap by end 23, and the International Habitat launch end 24. So the Russian airlock by completion would be then in 26. I would say this is already a challenging schedule, to be honest.
We have more questions.
Do you agree, Xavier?
Yeah.
Okay, Chris.
Your early slide showed that ESA is potentially contributing the ESPRI module, Habitat module, and the service module for Orion. Now, ESA isn't going to be able to contribute all those three modules. So which do you think ESA is most likely to contribute, the Habitat or ESPRI?
Well, let's be neutral. I like all of the three, but it's of course a question which one will or maybe contributed, and how that it was. It's a question of money and ambition, I would say.
You
could imagine my personal preference, Chris, but this is anyway not counting. It's really hard to say. There are very different considerations on that. Of course, the question on money and political interest to support has an important role. It's really hard to say on that. So Habitat is a very attractive topic where a lot of interest from different sides is in. ESPRI maybe is more kind of, I don't know, mandatory element, maybe less attractive for many others. So if you would have something like you have a mandatory thing to provide, could be the easier solution. The living and working room is of course a highly attractive piece for a lot of things. So maybe you have to show more ambitions in doing that. So it's different things you may consider. So it's
Do you think that creating and operating the Deep Space Gateway would be made easier if more space agencies were involved? For instance, smaller space agencies, not just NASA, ESA, and the such.
Well, if you think on Europe, it's basically ESA means there are all ESA member states in principle involved or can be involved, which is quite a big crowd. In general, I think each support is welcome. In the end, it's of course a matter of overall contribution of money in the end, how such a thing can be built. More partners will be obviously welcome. But I think an important element, and that's what we have seen throughout that work, is that the topic of international partnership is a very important topic also for the Americans. We hear that here in the conference, and we can all confirm that throughout the work we are doing. I think that's really an important aspect, and therefore I think even a small agency with small money, if you will be welcome, because this human aspect, is cooperation aspect, is something which is quite important. And we see it is for the space station, despite all international troubles we have, it works perfectly well, this cooperation. It's not just saying that, it's really the truth.
Oh, more questions over there.
Now perfect. I got a question regarding the orbit. Now the NRHO is not well known to be perfect for lunar surface. Is it more a compromise between Moon and Mars, or as you explained, as it has some good aspects for interplanetary simulation?
Yeah, I think compromise, maybe, I'm not sure whether this is the right word. Of course, each orbit you select has advantages and disadvantages. Of course, the cost to go directly to the moon from a low lunar orbit is lower once you are there. On the other hand, you, in terms of accessibility of different sites on the moon without changing inclination, it's easier go there. Of course, the simulation aspect of interplanetary flight is definitely an important one, because building a module for 16 eclipses a day, thermal-wise, power-wise, is a different thing. We have done it for the space station. It's not a matter of feasibility, but it's a different design and layout. And operationally, the communication aspect and the flight in a kind of, say, loneliness, more far away from planets, is, I think, operationally not to be underestimated. Yes, no orbit is perfect for everything, that's clear, but I think in this respect it's quite a good solution for doing for you for the different purposes.
Yeah, thank you for your presentations. In the last few days we have seen different architectures for the US side of the Gateway. We've seen the Lockheed Martin and the Northrop Grumman using Cygnus. Are you cooperating with both architectures, or because you have shown only one concept as far as the US side is concerned, but it looks like there are several versions?
As I said, the configuration is in evolution. We have seen different configurations over the last almost 3 years, and that is still ongoing. We are in the technical discussions we are doing. The share of functionality over different modules is still a topic in discussion. It was less for the habitats, more for other topics, for Esprit. There's a bigger discussion on that. Natural discussion, I would say. That's logic. So whatever you see now is certainly not the last configuration. Yes, we are also in discussion with international companies, and so this is ongoing. So whatever you see today, it's all similar, I would say. Not really different, but there are a lot of details which will still evolve. That's normal.
Thank you very much, Detlev. I see there's one more question over there.
Yeah, good afternoon. I would like to know if you have some data about the power module, which type of power EPS subsystem is using the American side, and which kind of electrical thruster, and if you have an overall amount of power generated by this module. Thank you.
I think there's somebody better suited to answer that. Matthias or Xavier? It's the solar generator providing the electrical energy. It's electric propulsion, but with the specification of that, I'm not so well.
So Matthias Robeck from OHB. So we are obviously following as well the Gateway. So what we have seen from the PPE side is that they are currently having as a baseline a 70 kilowatt bus. So 70 kilowatt would be in totally produced. And their solar electric propulsion would be based on very powerful head engines, which are, let me say, in the 12 to 15 kilowatt class. Does this answer the question? Yes? Okay.
Okay, first row.
Will the Gateway be open to the commercial companies in the same regard the ISS is, regarding that we don't have as much space on the Gateway as much as the ISS?
Yes, I think yes. There certainly the details are not yet defined. That's clear. It is also clear that we should have scientific utilization, commercial utilization opportunities for it. How this will be worked in detail, this is certainly still to be defined. That's clear. I think for that we are too early. In general, as you know, on the American side, also the procurement of different modules is going to be a more, I would say, industrial approach rather than maybe commercial is maybe not the proper word. This is done, but also in terms of utilization that will be certainly introduced. This is a strong trend in particular in the US, but elsewhere, and I'm sure this is going to be the case. But don't ask me how in detail today.
Yeah, the mic will come.
In the beginning of the space station, there was an idea to have a centrifuge. Is there a discussion that the centrifuge is necessary or would be a good idea for the new station?
I haven't heard of those discussions so far. not saying that it might be useful, but in the discussion so far, I haven't heard about that.
Good. Then, thank you very much, Detlef. Thank you very much for your attention. Then I would say we close. Thank you. Have a very good day and enjoy the continuation of the IEC. Have a good evening.